Hi everyone, welcome back to another episode of Ask Your Yia. I'm going to do something a little different in this episode. So before we begin, I have made a table of contents of what will happen in this video. You can click on the thumbnail to jump to the desired time. For this episode, I have a special guest that will be talking to us about walkability, and his name is Jeff Speck. He's a city planner and urban designer who is the author of Walkable City, How Downtown Can Save America One Step at a Time, and he also co-authored Suburban Nation, The Rise of Sprawl and the Decline of the American Dream. Welcome, Jeff. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
I remember listening to a City Lab podcast where they were briefly talking about the different modes of futuristic transportation, such as autonomous vehicles and the Hyperloop. But what's interesting is that they even went into something so simple, such as walking and bicycling. And I know you're pretty much the expert on walkability, Jeff. So I just had to bring you onto this series for you to share with us on what that is. So firstly, could you explain your general theory of walkability and how the car, which you stated, which originally was an instrument of freedom for the wealthy, but became a hazardous prosthetic tool for the masses?
The general theory of walkability, which I kind of, I guess I penned the name, but it's actually the work of many people who have come to this evolving conclusion, which is therefore a theory. You know, it's a hypothesis that keeps being modified by experience. Is that if people are to walk, to make the choice to walk in America, the walk has to be as good as the drive. And in America, there are so many inducements to driving. You know, our driving is extremely subsidized, as is the suburban sprawl that invites us to drive further and further by government programs and a whole other set of habits and structures in our financial system, our lending system, our division of labor system, such that, for example, someone is either typically a office park developer or a housing apartment developer or a single family developer, and we have this whole system that is building a landscape of independent single uses separated from other uses where walking is useless. And in that context, and with all the subsidizing we do of our cars, and with the fact that actually about four-fifths of the cost of driving is owning the car and only one-fifth is driving the car, if you look at the variable versus the fixed costs, what that adds up to is a circumstance where if you own a car, the smart thing to do is to drive it all the time. And it's sitting there in the driveway between you and everything. And so how do you get people to walk in that context, since most Americans, not all, but most Americans do have access to vehicles, or at least to people who will drive them around? And the answer is that the walk needs to be as good as a drive. To accomplish that, we say it needs to do four things. It needs to be useful, safe, comfortable, and interesting. I'll run through them very quickly. Useful, which I already alluded to, has to do with having a good mix of many different uses close at hand. That's what's measured by Walk Score, which you're probably aware of, the website that tells you wherever you're located, what your walk score is based on what's near you. And if you can get to work, get to school, get to the store, get to the soccer field, or to the coffee shop, or to other houses of people who make more or less money than you and therefore don't have the same house, if you can get to them in a 5-minute walk, then you live in a mixed-use neighborhood that is quite useful. Zoning has mitigated against that in the U.S. by separating uses from each other, by separating incomes from each other, and as we've learned, by separating races from each other. Zoning is a tool that the planning profession should actually be quite ashamed of, that essentially grew out of the desire, on the one hand, yes, to protect homes and families from industry and pollution, but also to protect the wealthy from the poor and the whites from non-whites. And it's something that's been very destructive to the usefulness of the American landscape. Secondly, safety has to do principally no longer with crime, but with the greatest killer of healthy adults, which is, I should say healthy people, which is the automobile. And when you're walking, if there are cars near you, the question is how fast are they going and how protected are you from them? So that adds up to all sorts of rules about how to design streets, and how we used to design them well, with narrow lanes and parallel parking, and avoiding long stretches of blocks that don't have intersections interrupting them. One-way travel that was introduced to many cities, where you have these multi-lane one-way streets that cause people to speed. And then, are there trees planted to protect the sidewalk? Are there, as mentioned, parallel parked cars to protect the sidewalk? There are all these details, and frankly, as a city planner, most of the work I do focuses on getting those details right, or I should say going into cities where they're wrong and correcting all the things that make it dangerous to be a pedestrian. And if you look at American cities, you find that the newest are the most deadly. And the older, the further back in time you get, typically, the earlier a city was planned and laid out and built, the safer the streets are. Because, as I like to say, cities that were designed around automobiles are really good at smashing them into each other. 4 out of the 5 most dangerous places to be a pedestrian are in the state of Florida. And that is due in part to the fact that Florida was developed mostly in the modern era. The third category is the comfortable walk, which is a little bit subtle and intellectual perhaps, but it deals with this concept of spatial definition and how we like to feel enclosed. When we're in a public space, we want to feel that we're in a place. And for a space to be a place, it needs to have good edges, good street walls. All animals, we're told by evolutionary biologists that all animals are simultaneously seeking prospect and refuge. You want to be able to see your predators, and you want to feel that your flanks are covered from attack. And if you don't have that feeling, you're not comfortable. So creating streets and public spaces with good tall edges up close to the street and no front parking lots, right, is essential to making our streets comfortable and our squares and plazas and all other parts of most other parts of the public realm. And then finally, the interesting walk has to do with the fact that Jane Jacobs, the smartest planning thinker ever, who wasn't a planner but wrote The Death and Life of Great American Cities, I believe in 1961, she wrote that nobody ever travels willingly from sameness to sameness, even if the effort expended is minimal. And that's a usefulness discussion also, as you can see, but it's also just a question of boredom. Like, who wants to walk down a street where there's no variety, where it's the same building for 600 feet, or where there's a blank wall or a parking structure up against the edge of the sidewalk? So the final prerequisite to walking is that we make sure that we enliven our sidewalk edges, not with blank walls or parking lots, but with stoops, windows, doors, ideally shops. And when you put those four things together, the useful, safe, comfortable, and interesting walk, you get a walk that people will choose to make, will delight in making, and that will get them out of their cars.
Yeah, that kind of reminds me of how like graffiti had its influence in like a lot of like more metropolitan areas, where they just changed like really empty concrete walls and like brightening up with a bunch of different colors. Do you think that might be a behavior that spawned to fill in that kind of gap? Not necessarily directly, but just indirectly.
I kind of doubt that the motivation behind most graffiti artists initially was in order to make walking more interesting.
Yeah.
Certainly there is this artistic urge to fill blank spaces and this horror vacui, that's the technical artistic term, wanting to decorate. And I often talk about not so much graffiti art, but all sorts of mural art and wall art as the best and most important place for us to spend our public arts dollars. I used to work at the National Endowment for the Arts, where I ran the design discipline. The NEA's first grant was for the Calder, so many years ago in the 60s, was for the Calder sculpture that sits on the plaza in Grand Rapids, Michigan, which is a lovely example of what we call plop art, where you drop some sort of inscrutable sculpture on a plaza, and that's the perhaps 1% that you've dedicated to art for in your public project. The Calder happens to be a beautiful example, but I've felt and advocated for some time that the best place, and really the first place that we should be spending our public art dollars, is to identify those places where, unfortunately, we're stuck with a blank wall. on some sort of corridor of potential walkability, people are turning around or choosing not to make the walk because all of a sudden there's 600 foot of parking structure or, you know, 400 feet of concrete wall. Where better to employ an artist to do something lively, interesting, and ideally beautiful to encourage people to make the walk there?
So going back to when you brought up zoning, which you called it, it's known as Euclidean zoning, but also single-use zoning. And I thought it was funny how you said that it kind of practically invented the soccer mom, where kids cannot really travel to the park anymore, so they have to get their parents to drive them. And I know that the cul-de-sac is kind of like an isolating feel, where like kids can't really go anywhere. Just the whole suburban sprawl idea, it doesn't really lead to much exploration for kids, so they kind of just stay in their own little realm. So I want to ask, like, what's the difference between that and the traditional neighborhood where everything you need is within walking distance? Because I spoke to you on email about when I went to study abroad in Japan, and typically in the center of a neighborhood is like a train station, and everything is just really dense and scrunched up, and you can just walk anywhere, and it's connected to a whole bunch of bus lines.
The term soccer mom and the term, the introduction of the term soccer mom to planning language, as opposed to just the culture at large, and its twin, or its partner, the cul-de-sac kid, were both introduced to me by Andres Duany, who is my mentor. The real thinkers behind the sort of ideas that I've been advocating for many years were my mentors, Andres Duany and Elizabeth Plater-Zyberg, who together are Duany, Plater, Zyberg & Company with their partners, also known as DPZ. And DPZ, I got to know them back in the 1980s with their design of Seaside, which was the first new mixed-use, truly walkable and traditionally organized town to be built in America since the middle of the 20th century, and it was built principally in the 80s and 90s in the Florida Panhandle. But I think it's important to understand that so many of my ideas still stem from their work, their research, their thinking. Andres used to talk about used to ask, you know, where were the soccer moms back in the 70s and 80s? You know, when I was growing up, there were no soccer moms because we lived in these traditionally organized neighborhoods in which the ball fields were within walking distance and the school was in walking distance and everything was organized around that measure, typically a 5 to 10 minute walk measure. The phenomenon of the cul-de-sac kid is very interesting because if you think about it, so many parents want to move to the suburbs and they picture this cul-de-sac for their children, which for a certain age child, until perhaps age 6 or even 5, because I have a 6-year-old and he'd be pretty bored in a cul-de-sac, but maybe until age 5 the cul-de-sac is the ideal environment for your child because it's safe. Ideally, no one's speeding down it. There aren't people passing through it, so you have a sense of privacy and probably a false sense of security. However, the problem with the cul-de-sac is that it's part of a system which as a whole is inaccessible. When you have a network of streets that are all connected, like the pre-war neighborhood that I grew up in and most people my generation grew up in, then there's a little bit of traffic on each street. No one street is overwhelmed by traffic. No one street is wide. Cars are moving slowly on every street. We played touch football on the street. We played ultimate frisbee in the street. And there's that classic scene from Wayne's World when they're playing street hockey and someone yells, car, car, and they move the net. And they move it back once the car goes by. That works. When you live in a cul-de-sac system, particularly one that's been designed comprehensively as part of a larger plan, the cul-de-sacs themselves are very safe, but once you leave the cul-de-sac, you're on a collector road, which is very unsafe. Because so few of the streets are actually connecting to each other, those few streets that do connect become overburdened with traffic, and they're wide for that reason. They're called collectors and arterials, and no smart parent is going to let their child out to walk along those, even if there is a sidewalk or a bike path. And so by gifting your child the cul-de-sac as a safe place to ride the big wheel until they're five or six, you're actually robbing them of independence in those years when they're 7 to 16. I live in Brookline, Massachusetts, which is a pre-war suburb of Boston. It's adjacent to Boston. It's actually surrounded by Boston. I'm looking out my window and I'm looking at the C line of the Green Line, which is one of the first trolleys ever built in America that passes my window every 5 minutes. My child goes to after-school events in Coolidge Corner, which is three stops from his school, the Driscoll School, which is located in Washington Square. He walks from school to the train, gets on the train, and rides to Coolidge Corner by himself. He's 8 years old. Imagine that happening in a cul-de-sac community. And also think about your child, not you perhaps, but other folks you know, who's growing up in that community, and how competitive he's going to be against my child, who from age 8 has been independent and taking the train, while most American kids are stuck in the back of the car. It used to be normal for 8-year-olds or even 6 or 7-year-olds to have a tremendous amount of independence, and now, of course, that's the rarity that's only available to people who have both the, I would say, the insight, but also the income to live in these older communities, which have become very expensive because people value the sort of lifestyle that you can have when you can walk.
Yeah, I remember when I studied abroad in Japan, my friends, like all the American students, were kind of a little culture shocked when they saw all these kids just walking around everywhere and like, where's their parents? And they just get on the train and just walk around very freely. But you don't really see that much nowadays. Like you kind of see like kids at the bus stop in a suburb, and then you have their parent hiding in the car next to the bus stop, kind of just like spectating. So,
and meanwhile, it's statistically much safer to be a child alone right now than it was when I was a kid. Statistically, you're safer. There's less predation. There's less crime. But of course, perceptions and the media would tell you otherwise. Mm-hmm. You also, your question also raised a topic I wanted to describe, which is that one of the first things you learn when you study planning is that settlement patterns, right? How we build on the land. Settlement patterns are a function of transportation systems. The lifestyle you experienced in Japan and that I experience in Brookline are functions of growing up around trains. When you have trains as the fundamental, you know, way to get around at speed, then your metropolis grows in a nodal shape. Wherever the train stops becomes a node, as you described, of restaurants and stores and higher density, if it's designed properly around that system. Of course, with streetcars, which stop very frequently, you can see a more linear pattern. So, for example, as Massachusetts Avenue leaves Harvard Square in Cambridge, there's a whole strip that goes through most of Cambridge and into Arlington, the adjacent town, that's a main street. And there you have kind of this linear pattern where the density decreases almost in a bell curve, where the center of that curve is the main street that runs for miles and miles. But the older systems of heavy rail and more distant stops, you know, space more distance from each other, resulted in this nodal kind of fried egg pattern, which you see in many traditional communities, including the small town I grew up in, which is called Belmont, Massachusetts, it used to be part of Cambridge, which essentially is a series of fried eggs, you know, where the yolk is the mixed use, surrounded by the white, which is housing, around what used to be train stops.
There was a quote in your book that I thought was very interesting, that it was by Thomas Jefferson, which he said, "When we get piled up upon one another in large cities, as in Europe, we shall become as corrupt as Europe." That pretty much laid the basis of kind of like the suburban sprawl thinking that would happen way later on, and kind of the idea of the American dream. And as you said in one of your TED Talks, that if you want a home in kind of like a cookie cutter suburban neighborhood, you're also asking for highway congestion because everybody's living further away, and commuting, which is often by car. So could you go into more detail about what induced demand is?
Sure. The full Jefferson quote said, "We shall become as corrupt as they are in Europe and take to eating one another as they do there," which I thought was fun to see that he had a sense of humor. But the real issue raised by that quote is the fact that America's kind of spiritual and ethical foundation has traditionally been agrarian, and that it was the nature of this country, no pun intended, to leave the city, go into the country. And there's an American tradition of abandoning old places, building new ones, and admiring somehow and a ton of literature from Jefferson on and before as well, admiring the agrarian lifestyle as somehow ethically or morally superior to an urban lifestyle. And that philosophy undergirds American history in a very powerful way that I think contributed mightily to the idealization and eventual canonization of suburban living as the American dream. And it found its way, of course, into policies that heavily subsidized both the highway system and suburban sprawl, and put us in a situation where I believe each suburban house is now happily subsidized 6 times as much as each urban dwelling by our various government institutions. The automakers and the other industries related to building highways also played a big role here, and the fact that the former president of GM was the head of the U.S. Department of Transportation during much of the planning of our highway system. There were conspiracies, don't get me wrong, there were conspiracies about tearing out streetcar lines, but mostly it was just this amazing national consensus in celebration and adoration of the automobile, which caused us to all choose this direction of growth, despite all the economical inefficiencies and costs and the need for subsidization, and of course the environmental outcomes, which are now potentially going to create the apocalyptic outcome that your future city is based upon. Now, induced demand, which I mentioned earlier, is the simple fact of the data. And the data shows that when you widen a highway or build a new highway in a congested system, and this discussion only applies where there's congestion, that immediately, to the degree that you've added new capacity, 40% of that capacity is taken up by new trips that weren't there before, typically, on average. And within 4 years, on average, 100% of that capacity has been matched by new trips. And so you went from having, 10 lanes of congestion to 12 lanes or 14 lanes of congestion, but your lifestyle has not improved after spending billions of dollars, and it's often billions of dollars, on improving this road. The reason this happens is because in congested systems, the principal constraint to driving is congestion. Congestion is the only real way we're made to pay for driving fully in our automotive lives. The roads are subsidized, the parking is subsidized, the fuel is dramatically subsidized. And because driving is so subsidized, it's what economists refer to as a free good. And the way the market responds to a free good, it's the same reason the Russians couldn't keep bread on the shelves. The Soviets, they couldn't keep bread on the shelves in the supermarket because they had an artificially low price for it. So of course the demand went through the roof. And that's what happens with driving. And the only way to fix it is to have driving cost us what it costs society. And we're so far off right now that the only way we pay the price of driving is through being stuck in traffic. Therefore, if you remove that constraint, more people make the choice to drive. There's one other solution, which I've already implied, which would be a congestion-based tolling, where you ask people to pay a certain toll based upon, it's like any other, it's like Uber, right? You pay more, you pay surge pricing when there's a higher demand, and that allows the market to function extremely efficiently. And if our major roads were tolled in this manner, that's the only other way. Actually, it's the only way. It's the only way to fix congestion is to have a market, is to allow the market system to reign. And the way to do that is to have the price meet the value. And congestion pricing does that. But Americans have never been able to pull it off. Meanwhile, you know, many other cities, countries and cities like London have pulled it off with incredible positive outcomes in terms of congestion, in terms of bus efficiency, in terms of pollution, air and noise. But in America, we seem to be extremely loath to do anything that in any way constrains automobile use.
In your book, you mentioned the book Technopoly, where it speaks about the technological imperative, which is new technology that quickly becomes adopted, such as the impending autonomous vehicles that will come into our lives no matter what, like any other technological device that has come before, such as a smartphone. I was watching the United Conference of Mayors 2017, and you said that autonomous vehicles are the right answer to the wrong question. Could you go more into detail about that?
Sure, yeah, and I would direct your listeners to my website, jeffspeck.com, jeffspeck.com, where you'll find all my TED Talks and other talks, but I would love it if more people would watch my talk just about a month ago to the U.S. Conference of Mayors, where they had asked me to speak to them about autonomous vehicles. And I pointed out a whole bunch. I basically came up with 10 rules for mayors about how to ensure, or at least do their best to ensure, that when autonomous vehicles come to their city, they have more of a positive impact than a negative impact. When all of the kind of thought experiments you do carefully about autonomous vehicles would lead you to reach the conclusion that they're much more likely to have a negative impact on cities than a positive impact. And to support that, I'll say, you know, a single L train in Manhattan carries 2,000 as many people per hour as a car. And the idea that we're going to somehow replace our transit systems with these swarming vehicles, which are still cars and will be principally single occupancy because that's how Americans travel, the idea that you can replace, a 2,000 person train with a swarming group of vehicles that are not going to cause you to double the size of all your streets is preposterous. So we need to think much more carefully about what the real future of autonomy is. But I think that, like so many innovations in the U.S., like the electric car, which obviously has many positive outcomes, or the hybrid vehicle, it's the right answer to the wrong question. The question that technologists in the U.S., from the folks at Caltech to MIT and everywhere else, you know, our smartest young scientists, or maybe not so young, the question they're always asking is, how can we make cars better? And that's a very small-minded, narrow-minded question. The proper question is, how can we provide mobility better? And that's even a smaller-minded question than, how can we give people access to the things they need in their daily life better? Because when you start thinking about mobility instead of just automobility, you then move into ways of moving around that are much more efficient, much more environmentally sound, and much better for creating community than being stuck in the automobile, which you know makes you a very antisocial person. I've never given anyone the finger while walking, but you know I have while driving. So that's the first step. But the second step is to say, why are we moving around so much in the first place? And that's a city planning issue. And it's because we haven't built neighborhoods which are mixed use and walkable. and provide us most of our daily needs, not all of them, but many or most of our daily needs within walking distance. And actually the best solution, you know, that technologists should be working on, and maybe the Y Combinator people who are rethinking cities from the ground up are doing this, but I somehow doubt it. The best question to answer is, how can we create a city in which people require the least mobility because they have access to so many things close at hand? That's the question our technologists should be solving, rather than, you know, just making cancer a little bit better, you know?
Well, thank you, Jeff. I immensely appreciate having you and spending your time here on this episode of Astrodia. It's been a real pleasure to have you with us speaking about walkability. If you guys want to learn more about what Jeff Speck has talked about, I highly recommend you reading his book, Walkable City: How Downtown Can Save America One Step at a Time. It's a good read and a relatively short one. It's just a little over 300 pages, but definitely worth it. Would you have any ending remarks, Jeff?
Well, just to say, people often refer to the book as short. It's not short, but it's written in a way that's fun to read, so people think it's short. I think if your listeners pick it up, they will not regret it. And thank you for the forum and for your intelligent questions.
Now let's go on ahead and apply what Jeff Speck has taught us about walkability. I'll apply this to the Serendipity neighborhood as the first demonstration, but for the rest of the series, we will apply these rules everywhere to achieve a walkable city. Here we have the designated land for the Serendipity neighborhood. This will be a dense mixed-use neighborhood that will apply a variety of walkable roads that will be specially designed. Since this is close to the city center, Yugen, half of the neighborhood will noticeably consist of high-density buildings, but will ramp outwards in a gradient, touching the Weilikia neighborhood and the Treyel Boulevard with lower-density buildings such as family homes, while still retaining a mixed-use zoning policy and walkable roads. Now let's go into detail about the plans for this neighborhood. For the Serendipity neighborhood, we will have a main street cutting through the center, touching three major intersections where vehicles will drive through. There will be also many other smaller roads, only for pedestrian and service vehicle use. At the intersections, there will be a single lane roundabout, connecting with narrow two-way roads. On the left side, the high-density buildings will mainly reside there, but on the right side, running adjacent to the Treyel Boulevard, will be medium to low-density buildings. In the future, I will build a major roundabout at the end of the Treyel Boulevard, named the Saudade Sphere. Let's look at a few roads that Astrodia will mainly consist of from now on. These are just the bare bones of the roads. I will later go into detailing in the video. On the far left is the multimodal street, with a narrow two-lane road for cars, a protected bike path, and enlarged sidewalks for pedestrians. Second from the left is a narrow road with enlarged pedestrian paths. Second from the right is another form of the road on the far left, but minus one enlarged sidewalk on the right side. On the far right is a tram track with enlarged sidewalks. Eventually, trams will be implemented into the city. I will introduce more roads in the future, but for this episode, I'll be using the one on the far left. I will start by first building the road that's among the Pulsar map appendages and connect it to the main street of the Serendipity neighborhood. Since it's the future, autonomous vehicles will not need such wide lanes to travel. Therefore, this is why I'm using this narrow two-way road. And because autonomous vehicles will operate as a public good in this setting, there is no need for curbside parking. However, because of the game mechanics, we will use curbside parking roads if necessary. Beside the narrow road is a protected bike path. According to Jeff Speck's book, a protected bike path helps immensely for bicyclists and pedestrians by providing a buffer from vehicular traffic on the road. He also noted in his book that curbside parking adds a layer of steel between the motor traffic and the pedestrians. This adds to his second rule of achieving walkability: the walk must feel safe. This also helps with protecting storefronts, such as where cafes exist with outdoor dining. However, since there is no curbside parking on the road, another alternative Jeff stated for protecting pedestrians from automobile traffic is to add trees. Trees psychologically slow down traffic, human drivers that is, and also protects pedestrians. This is a form of traffic calming treatment, but since we're dealing with autonomous vehicles, these trees will just add shade and comfort to citizens, and this pertains to his third rule, the walk must be comfortable. I will go more into the usefulness of trees shortly. Sadly, when I was constructing the first intersection connecting to the main street, my video corrupted, so I have built a reflected layout of the second intersection here. As you can see, the first intersection on the right side of the screen has already been built with buildings, so I'll do this again on this intersection. The main connections to this area are roundabouts to allow for better flow of vehicular traffic. There are a number of smaller roads for pedestrians to travel on as well. Let's go into detailing on these main roads. I will first start by adding planters on the sides of the narrow street and the protected bike path. These planters will be the foundations of where the trees will be planted, and as I mentioned before, trees add a barrier between the pedestrians and the vehicular traffic. If you guys remember, I stated in my Wild Einsamkeit episode, trees help add a microclimate of keeping ambient temperatures comfortably low for inhabitants. A simple example of how trees are useful for living organisms is looking at a large grass field of a farm with a lone tree. Beneath the tree are dozens of cows seeking refuge from the hot weather. Another example is from a study conducted at a suburban hospital in Pennsylvania from 1972 to 1981. They examined 200 beds. Half of those rooms faced a brick wall while the other faced a row of trees. They concluded that patients who had the view of the trees required less narcotics, had few negative evaluations, and were on average discharged a day earlier than their brick wall counterparts. Trees also reduce the burden on sewage systems by absorbing stormwater. As an inch of rain falls on a tree, the first 30% of the precipitation is absorbed directly by the leaves and never touches the ground. Once the leaves are saturated, up to 30% more of rain seeps into the porous soil created by the tree's root structure. The roots absorb the water back into the tree, which eventually transpire back into the air. A mature tree can absorb half an inch of water from every rainfall. In the middle, I have placed larger trees separating the bike path as seen on the right from the road on the left. On the sides of both the bike path and the sidewalk on the far left, I have placed short cypress trees. In the future, with different neighborhoods, I will use different trees. Going to the roundabout, you can see how narrow the streets are. This roundabout will act as a square where people can commune, but I will add a larger dedicated square shortly. Let's start adding buildings to show what the developed environment will look like. Remember, this will be the high-density portion of the Serendipity neighborhood. When placing down these buildings, you must keep in mind of how it appears from a pedestrian. Try to eliminate all blank walls, and add nice shops on the streets. This pertains to Jeff Speck's fourth rule, the walk must be interesting. Allow the community to partake in placemaking, which is a people-driven approach of city planning that seeks to capitalize on a local community's assets, inspirations, and potential to create public places that will benefit its people. Let's talk about shapes. In Jeff Speck's book, the third rule in achieving walkability is that the walk must be comfortable. One of the ways this can be achieved is to create nice shapes where spaces exist. In city planning and architecture, there is a division between figural spaces and figural objects. The tall blue building on the left takes on the figural object, which is a unique yet strangely shaped building. On the right is a building that takes on the figural space design. What's the difference? Well, the building on the right contours with the shape of the road. That way, buildings are designed to the shapes that roads have allowed. For example, take a look at Paris. As you can see, the buildings are designed to contour with the shapes that have been formed by roads. This is part of traditional urbanism, which has existed for thousands of years, where people built buildings and markets beside the road, not building roads around buildings. On the left is a design perspective in more recent times. The figural object, which is that buildings shape how the road should be shaped. This is often done by the building's irregular shape, where it must be met by either green spaces, which are often unwalkable, boring, and useless, or parking lots. Basically, it's too far from the sidewalk. An example would be skyscrapers in China, where the base does not contour with the shape of the road, so in order to fill the void, it is met with landscaping and parking lots. You can see this with a modernist city planning design called Towers in the Park, which is used for high-rise apartment complexes and in the designs of the French-Swiss architect Le Corbusier. These modernist designs have been part of the urban renewal initiatives in the 1960s to 1970s, which have been failures because they are just simply too far away from sidewalks. Obviously, Astrio will be taking on the figural space perspective, where buildings contour with the shape of the roads, and this has become more achievable through recent modding achievements in city skylines, such as Rico and the MoveIt mod. Now let's talk about neighborhood structure. In the interview, I asked Jeff Speck about neighborhood structure, and also in his book, he explained that traditional neighborhoods had an apparent center, where people commune, and an apparent edge. However, for Serendipity, it is a little iffy given by the shape of the designated land, but I'm going to place the center here, with a neighborhood square, and fill the edges with lower density buildings. A real life example, Georgetown, Washington, D.C., one of the oldest neighborhoods in America. Where's the center here? Well, it can be a little hard to see, but it could be this main street named Wisconsin Avenue that is walkable from the surrounding residential area. A main street is a primary road for commercial businesses like retailers and restaurants. Now let's look at something more recent, like this suburban sprawl neighborhood in Florida named Buenaventura Lakes. Do you see a real neighborhood center aside from the geometrical center? There's really no center here. That wide road on the right is not a main street, but a collector road. As Jeff said, it is not an ideal place to walk or commune, as its purpose is to hold higher volume of traffic that trickle down from the residential homes. For the Serendipity neighborhood, the center will be this neighborhood square that sits parallel to the main street. What I want to talk about next is zoning. The first rule in achieving walkability, according to Jeff Speck, is that the walk must be useful. Well, what does that mean? Well, basically, is wherever you are going. Is it convenient? It isn't really helpful to walk somewhere far away like a convenience store, which is ironically not convenient at all. So that's why I'm going to put emphasis on mixed-use zoning, but this has been a little difficult in city skylines since the first floor of a building cannot be something else like a store, and the floors above it residential. But you could just do mixed-use zoning by temporal and spatial placement, like a residential building and a commercial building next to each other. In the United States, Euclidean zoning, or single-use zoning, is very popular, but this has led to a number of problems that we're all familiar with, such as sprawl, urban decay, environmental pollution, and racial and socioeconomic segregation. In this type of urban planning, zones are segregated from each other, like the suburbs are here, the shops are there, and the industry is over somewhere else, which is best for industry anyway. I find it misleading that some officials and people call single-use zoning traditional zoning, when it was made recently, dating back to some time during the Industrial Revolution, when factories were interwoven with other zones and it became noisy and hazardous to public health. Thus, single-use zoning was born, to separate the two. However, the real traditional zoning has always been mixed use. Mixed use existed because everything was in walking distance, and as you know, we didn't have cars back then, and not everyone owned a horse and buggy. Mixed-use zoning exists in a variety of ways, through vertical or horizontal, temporal and spatial. It can be more than just a storefront on the first floor and a house on the upper floors, but it can be conveniently located zones that are integrated into one location, like this neighborhood in San Diego's Uptown District, for example. For Serendipity, I'm going to integrate commercial and office businesses alongside the main street, and have residential interwoven with the main street as well, but mostly exist on the plots away from the main street, like the edges. One of the key elements to having a walkable neighborhood is to have a main street or a public space. But for this neighborhood, it will have both. The neighborhood square will be a relatively small but still a nice piece of spacious land for a public space. Located across the street is a university. It has two towering parts to it with a base for dorms or student commons. To make things more convenient, I have placed subway connections in this square so people in the area could enter it or those arriving can explore the main street in the square. When dealing with squares, there is a height to width ratio. Often, smaller squares are better as larger squares can offer less amenities, especially if the buildings encompassing the large square are not tall at all. If the square is big, it is better to have it flanked by taller buildings. However, not too tall, because only a certain amount of vertical floors can effectively interact with the people on the street. Jan Gao, a Danish urban designer, stated that skyscrapers are like vertical cul-de-sacs. That means only those closest to the ground can conveniently remain in contact with the ground level, whereas those high up have a longer social distance. He also noted that buildings at about the 10th story floor capture wind currents, making wind on the ground level up to 4 times stronger. So this leads to a question of whether taller buildings degrade walkability by their presence or improve the capacity. Basically, the more people a building can hold, the more people are out walking out on the street below it. As seen in Manhattan and Hong Kong, the height of tall skyscrapers that generate wind vortexes have little negative effect on the pedestrian life down below. But I did go ahead and limit the amount of tall buildings in this area and just overall in Serendipity. Why? Because of an urban design called Vancouverism, which I will go over shortly, but this is why I'm using these medium density buildings, and especially buildings like this Barnes & Noble asset on the workshop, because it works great for corners. I wish there were more buildings like this on the workshop that will satisfy the shapes of spaces like corners and edges. Especially with games like SimCity and City Skylines, triangle buildings are just rare, and only now just resurfacing on the workshop with advancements in modding over the past year. For this square, I have arranged the tents as I want it to be like a marketplace, with booths, food stalls, and etc. all around. I take inspiration from my time in Taiwan when my Taiwanese friend took me to see a night market in Tainan, the former capital of Taiwan. I am still working on my detailing skills, which obviously lacks compared to Fruxtrance and Strictoaster, but I want to try and beautify as much as I can using the available props on the workshop. I really want to show emphasis of people here by using an asset called Park People Generator, recommended by Addis, as I was looking for a way to attract people. It does its job pretty okay, but I think for the best is to not have so many pedestrians in one spot, as it would create immense lag, as I'm already getting 8 frames per second looking at this. I also went ahead and filled in the empty spaces around the edges of the neighborhood with green spaces and amenities. This should offer a variety of things to do for those dwelling in high-density buildings. As you can see, I have allowed curbside parking in some places just to take advantage of the game mechanics. Again, these green spaces are much needed to help keep temperatures lower in urban environments, but dealing with walkability, these green spaces should not be unnecessarily too big. Over here, I made an elementary school located in the midst of this density. I try not to make it flanked by too many tall buildings up so suddenly. As you can see, there are some open spaces around the elementary school. This principle is part of Vancouverism, which I will again go over shortly. But why I decided to place an elementary school here is, well, one, I needed an elementary school, two, I really like the colors of the building, and three, it brings relief to the urban landscape that is already so dense in this high density portion of the Serendipity neighborhood. You can see in the playground I've added a number of structures for kids to play in, including that corner filled with sand where kids can go build and play with sand. I tried to make a lush barrier between the school and the outside for the children, as in having trees and bushes surrounding the school fences so kids can run around while being surrounded by nature, but also by tall buildings which they can marvel at. Let's take a look at the intersections on Main Street. This is the first intersection, which I have it flanked by shops like Fresh Market and Barnes & Noble. I just really love the shape of that Barnes & Noble building, so you'll see it a lot throughout this neighborhood in filling corners. And there's never any congestion on these roads, even with them being so narrow, so the walkability is really being taken advantage here. Now let's look at the second intersection on the Main Street. Here you can see that bicyclists are really utilizing the bike paths, which I love watching in this game. I just love watching all the pedestrians and the bikes just moving around in the city, but it does create a lot of lag, unfortunately. So across the street is an Akiba store from Tokyo. I use that building because of all the signs and graphics that it has, which I wish there were more assets like it on the workshop so we can fill in these corners. Now let's start on the lower density portion of the Serendipity neighborhood. First, I'm going to continue the main street down here and also change this avenue into a multimodal street with a tram track. This will be part of a future line that I'll talk about later when I get into trams. I'm going to put some taller buildings over here as a visual and sound barrier between the neighborhood and the railroad tracks. Lastly, in this area, I'm going to put a community farm or garden where the community can grow food. So what is Vancouverism? Vancouverism is an urban design approach developed by the City of Vancouver, Canada. It is characterized as having tall, slim towers juxtaposed with mid to low rise development to allow for sun, air, and views of the sky, and views for the high rises to see the city and mountains, and all connected by bike paths, improved walkability, and integration with the natural environment. However, there is more to this as claimed by Vancouver, as their success has been largely based upon value-driven evolutionary process in which local government planners, developers, and citizenry have committed over the past few decades to form a consensus vision of what their city should look like, and also putting forth creative solutions in achieving that vision. Vancouver is known for its view of the mountains and the water. I was lucky to grab a glimpse of the mountains and the city when I had a connecting flight in Vancouver. But that was unfortunately all I saw within my very short stay, as I connected immediately to my next flight. Because of these views, there are a number of regulations in place to not obstruct views. Architects and builders had to work around 27 different viewpoints, known as view corridors, that pass through the city. These view corridors are like hallways, where residents in tall slim towers have a view of something and cannot be obstructed by law. For example, a corridor can stretch into the views of the mountains, and no building can be built within that corridor to obstruct the mountain views of another building. Vancouver goes to great lengths in protecting private views, where they would use complex computer analysis to see if any vantage points are obstructed from another building. Vancouver's view corridors are arguably the most heavily regulated development space in North America, as the city immensely values its visual beauty. That in 2010 that the City Council not only voted to preserve existing corridors, but also added 2 more. There has been arguments that all these regulations had slowed Vancouver's growth, but it did not stop creativity. One example is the Vertical Forest Building by architect Arno Matis. The building's design incorporates 6 different geometrical forms, which not only conform to the view corridor regulations, but also provide angles that will allow for production of passive solar heating and cooling. The process was rigorous for architect and developer Armin Virani, as he had to go through an 18-month process of not only being scrutinized by city planners, but also meetings with neighborhood residents, who urged Matisse to create an edgier and innovative design. Matisse said, "One of the key concerns was that we want to avoid another cookie-cutter tower." Vancouver has largely been defying the car culture that has taken over the world, as it learned from the mistakes of others, such as the United States. In the book, Dream City, Vancouver and the Global Imagination, by Lance Berlowitz, he writes, "It was largely bypassed by the worst of North American urban renewal. Freeways, elevated and underground pedestrian systems, huge shopping malls, big box retail, oversized curvy linear dead-end streets in place of the traditional street grid. Vancouver is not surrounded and bisected by freeways. The city escaped that fate in the late 1960s and early 1970s, when municipal officials at that time feared urban stagnation and decay, thus wanted to propose a massive urban renewal project by obliterating neighborhoods such as Chinatown and Gastown to build elevated throughways. The citizens simply rose up and said no way, and the politicians were turned out of office. Vancouver was founded in the late 1880s as a port and railroad center for the region's timber and mineral wealth, and was a Victorian-style urban village, and residents wanted it to remain that way instead of hastily morphing into a typical car-centric modern metropolis. 4 decades later, Vancouver is still this old streetcar city, where tram lines still exist with people walking, cycling, and taking public transportation, enough so that the car doesn't dominate. However, it is wrong to say that Vancouver is waging a war against cars. Cars have a place, but they have to be part of the mix. Much of Vancouver's downtown development is in tower podium style, which is that the base of the building fills up the block and then followed by a much narrower tower. This pertains to what I said before, figural space where the building contours with the shape of the road, rather than just a straight skyscraper that is met with landscaping and parking lots down below. It is assumed that the style was borrowed from Hong Kong or other similar high-density Asian cities, but co-director of planning for Vancouver during the 1990s and early 2000s, Larry Beasley, said that it's more of a homegrown style that actually reflects the influence of European urban landscapes, because it creates more street-level activity and gives pedestrians a more interesting environment to walk in. This pertains to Jeff Speck's third and fourth rule, the walk must be comfortable and interesting. Beasley says you can't just have towers and vacant plazas, but also housing and shops. One of the key points in Vancouver's development came during the late 1980s, after the city hosted the 1986 World's Fair that commemorated the city's centennial. The fair gave the city a chance to pump the local economy with public works projects during a recession, and left the city with some important assets like the SkyTrain, a rapid transit line. The expo site itself was converted into a new dense urban neighborhood that is around green parks rather than along the waterfront. Designed by Stanley Kwok, the park created a shared amenity while connecting the buildings to one another. This, alongside the opposition of highways, Vancouver presented itself once again by hosting the 2010 Winter Olympics and built the Olympic Village that used energy efficiency and sustainability systems such as solar heating and green roofs. They plan to convert the area for residential commercial uses after the event. Vancouver is a great model to look at as its urban planning focuses on livability, which means creating a city of neighborhoods where people can live, work, play, and shop. Lastly, I want to talk about the name, serendipity, which is often chosen by Britain's favorite English word, alongside with nincompoop and discombobulate, the making of happy and unexpected discoveries by accident. A pleasant surprise. It was invented by the writer and politician Horace Walpole in 1754 as an allusion to serendip, an old name for Sri Lanka. Walpole was a prolific letter writer, and he explained to one of his main correspondents that he had based the word on the title of a fairy tale, The Three Princes of Serendip, the heroes of which were always making discoveries, by accidents and sagacity, of things they were not in quest of. Incidentally, the original Persian name for Sri Lanka, and in earlier times, Ceylon, was Sarandib, a corruption of the Sanskrit word Sinhaladipva, which literally meant the island where lions dwell. I chose this word because perhaps wherever you walk around in this neighborhood, or anywhere in Astoria in general, you may come across a pleasant surprise of meeting new friends or seeing new things. And in conjunction with the Trail Boulevard and Place de l'Entente that is adjacent to this neighborhood as seen in last episode, I think serendipity works great as a play on history, It was a pleasant surprise to see wartime cease over a shared notion of peace on Christmas Day. Here is the completed lower density section of the Serendipity neighborhood. Firstly, for the community garden, it has a biodome which I think suits the futuristic theme that Esther Ye is in. There is also an elementary school located in the vicinity of the gardens, as children can learn while being among plants, and a place where they can be taught natural sciences. I think community living benefits when growing things together. I'll go more into detail about different forms of community and urban farming, like vertical forests, in another episode. As you can see, the urban design approach of Vancouverism is applied here with towering skyscrapers separated by medium to low density buildings to allow for sun, air, and views. For the tall skyscrapers, I use an asset with a tower podium architectural style to fill out the block. In the future, I'm going to go more into detail of applying view corridors into Esther Ye so residents can enjoy the natural scenery of the island. But I'm going to end it here as this episode is already nearing 1 hour long. So I want to say thank you for joining me once again in Esther Ye, and I want to say thank you to Jeff Speck for also joining us and sharing his knowledge on what makes walkable cities walkable. Again, if you want to find out more about his works, check out his website in the description box below. I hope your day has a wonderful serendipity. See you in the future.